Freak out.
Yeah. He's like doing rows. He's doing lots of stuff.
Guess what I have?
What?
the surface.
Oh, nice.
But we maybe he said it to Alex's. Yeah, he said it to Alex.
Oh, yeah.
Well, that's a nice looking slide deck.
Thanks. So
it
goes for about half an hour.
Oh, yeah, that's fine. Yeah.
If I'm going too long, just be like, get off.
She's gonna send it to. She's gonna email it to.
I can just look at it. To Google Slides.
No, no, it's on Google Slides.
It's on Google Slides.
Log it through. Use your computer to get it.
Yeah.
You want to just kill the user off the screen?
Yeah.
Man, that really. We should have figured that out. Google Slides. Like, how are you going to get into the computer?
Yeah.
Yeah. Is it in the computer?
Cool.
All right, guys, we're gonna get started.
Whoa.
It's good.
Like fade out. Harsh. Cool. Well, welcome everyone. Thanks for braving the cold weather. I know it's harsh conditions outside, so thanks for coming by. To the next installment of our monthly music meetup. Thanks for coming out. They're setting up the second presentation. Don't look at Alex's emails. Very private. We can clearly see everything. Cool, well, welcome. So we have two presenters tonight. If you guys have been coming the last couple months, you know that the guys from South by Southwest have come by and they have been promoting the conference, which is great, and they've also been giving away some free badges, which is awesome, and we're lucky enough to have Hugh from South By here again tonight. So let me just turn it over to Hugh, who's gonna come up and do his presentation, and then we have our main event for the night. So come on up, Hugh. And do you need the HDMI cord? I think you might have to hit HDMI on that.
Likely. That makes sense.
There we go. Right there. Okay, we're good.
Yeah. All right, have a dull moment. thanks again for coming out. My name is Hugh Forrest. I am Chief Programming Officer, which you can't see on there because that's cut off. South by Southwest. You can always reach me, hugh@sxsw.com. By the Twitters, I am Hugh@_W_Forrest. Who is that?
Maybe unplug it? Yeah.
Resolution is not.
There we go. Hopefully
that gets it. All right, there we go. So Dr. Hugh.
There we go.
Okay. So if you were here last time, you may notice that the presentation looks suspiciously familiar. In fact, it is. The slides have changed. I'm going to talk about, very briefly, 10 cool music-focused sessions for South by Southwest 2019. I'm going to explain them in 5 minutes or less, maybe a tad longer. And then we're going to do a free badge giveaway. Again, my name is Hugh Forrest, and there's all my contact information. So we had our biggest content announcement of the season today from a conference standpoint. 600 plus sessions announced. You can find all this information at sxsw.com. You'll see a blog post at the top of the page, which will take you to the South by Southwest schedule. Once on the schedule, There's a search bar at the top right corner. You use that to find the stuff that interests you most. These 600 sessions that we announced, released today, came in via the Southwest Southwest panel picker. People in the room may have entered speaking proposals. Congrats if you got in. Very competitive process. As always, again, the Southwest Southwest panel picker is very competitive. We got about 5,000 ideas, and 600 of those accepted today. We'll accept a few more of those along the way. Tomorrow, October 17th, is our first big music fest announcement of the season. So again, watch the Southwest Southwest website tomorrow. I think we're going to announce about 100 bands tomorrow. But for now, let me quickly review 10 of the most interesting music-related sessions that we announced today. And again, these are all stuff you can find on the Southwest Southwest website. Session number one, Music Technology Elevator Pitch Session. This is the leader of this solo session. His name is Brian Zisk. He calls himself a parallel entrepreneur specializing in digital media, web broadcasting, and distribution technologies. He is founder of Buzzmakers and produces the San Francisco Music Tech Summit. The description of this session is as follows. Everyone is welcome to stand and present a 1-minute pitch about a music technology related company or idea. Pitch your startup services or skills, find resources, or connect with others who might be interested in working together. Kind of sounds suspiciously familiar to what we do here, right? Okay, idea number two, artists in control, technology and the new DIY. The leader of this solo session is this woman who is Meredith Graves, who is the director of music at Kickstarter. Meredith embodies the spirit of creative independence at the core of Kickstarter. She's a talented writer who explores music, language, and identity. Her publications include Pitchfork, Sense, and ID. She is also the founder and front woman behind a hardcore punk band, which name I probably should not say here. In the last year, the blockchain has appeared, this is the description of this session, has appeared as a potential solution for many of the problems facing anyone looking to release music. Fair pay trade for streaming, expedited payments, transparent distribution, but what the heck is a smart contract anyway? Can these technologies really streamline royalty payments, add transparency to an until now murky process? You're going to see that quite a lot of these proposals or these sessions focus on blockchain. Third one here is another solo session, how digital voice assistants will disrupt music. The leader of this session is a woman named Jaquille Horton, whose picture I could not find, so we're just looking at digital voice assistant. Jaquille is a 12-year music and entertainment industry executive. She was recently named a product manager at Google for YouTube, probably 2/3 of the efforts of the company's, and was selected as one of the top innovative bets of 2018. This session is all about, this talk will reveal the latest tech innovations and industry players that are using artificial intelligence to impact music within creation, distribution, discovery, consumption, and fan engagement. Session number four, self-sovereignty, open protocols, and the future of music. This is a panel. One of the speakers on that panel is Panos Panay, who is the founder and current managing director of the Berklee Institute for Creative Entrepreneurship, as well as a passionate entrepreneur, educator, and startup mentor. Description of this session is as follows. As art and money becomes increasingly reduced to data and thus increasingly fluid, how will rights holder data be tracked? Who will own it? And how might an open protocol enable artists to better track and monetize the content they create? Technologies such as blockchain and distributed ledgers are creating new opportunities for self-sovereignty, whether in supply chains, emerging nations, or for the new media industry. Again, blockchain is a theme that runs throughout here. This is a next panel is the future of live experiences. This gentleman is Matt Lawler, who is director of digital media at AEG. AEG, as you may know, is the largest sports and entertainment group in the world. Acting as an internal agency for AEG, Global Partnerships oversees worldwide sponsorship, sales, and activation for over 135 world-class platforms across 5 continents and numerous other assets. This session is about the future of live experiences such as sports, concerts, and theater venues is radically changing. The rollout of 5G will trigger a revolution in AR and spatial mapping technologies. Nexus Studios, a leader in immersive storytelling in the AEG, where this gentleman is from. The world's leading sports and live entertainment company are working closely to enhance live experiences with immersive technologies. Sixth one, yes, this is a panel, but a little comedic break here. The panel is titled, What I Like About You, Music and Brands Partnerships, and yes, that's a picture of the Romantics way back when. The description of this panel is as follows, armed with data generated by digital distribution and social media platforms, smart marketers are now empowered to create partnerships with artists that are far more strategic and targeted than ever before. This is, again, one of the music panels for 2019, and certainly ties in with a lot of the brand and agency stuff we're seeing at South by Southwest now. This is another session that is focused on blockchain. This one is actually within the blockchain track, which happens at the second half of the week of South by Southwest, i.e. during the music content. This panel is called Value and Art in a Tokenized World. This is a panel, and this woman's name is Kat Mustata. She is a playwright and technologist whose work explores the intersection of technology and the arts. She's the 2018 TED resident whose project is focused on the role of artists in the age of machine intelligence. Description for this session, thanks to blockchain technology, any asset can now be tokenized, from art to royalties to stocks to portfolios. The implications for art are profound and go beyond merely authentication of digital works or tracking provenance. If you were here last week or last month and the month before, you remember that the other new track that we have during the music portion of the week is called Cannabusiness. Including one from there. This is Non-Obvious Trends in the Cannabis Industry. This is led by this woman who is Nancy Whiteman. She is heralded as the queen of legal weed by Inc. magazine. Nancy Whiteman is founder and CEO of Buona Brands. Nancy directs the development and partnerships and licensing agreements domestically and internationally for this brand. She also leads the company's strategic vision and has been instrumental in Buona Brands' growth into new and emerging markets. The description of this session, Nancy will explore the non-obvious trends in the cannabis industry, including how do you get out ahead of where the market is going while still running a profitable business today, and how to spot a real trend and not just marketing hype. The next one is near and dear, again, to this group. It is called Music Tech Meetup. This is, again, part of the meetup content that we have at the 2019 event. This will be led by a woman named Cheryl Woodhouse. She was the COO of Rock, Paper, Scissors, where she oversees strategy, finances, and a team of 15 who together handle publicity for music tech companies, music festivals, and hundreds of global music artists, as well as organize industry events like the CD Baby DIY Musicians Conference. The description of this is as follows. Rock, Paper, Scissors' fourth annual music tech meetup continues to grow every year and is the place to meet other music tech leaders, expand your horizons, and make lots of new industry friends. Last year, there were 160 people in the room, perhaps more this year. Okay, the 10th of my 10 music sessions from today's announcement. Again, you can find all these at southwest.com. Where does creativity come from? This woman is part of this panel. Her name is Dr. Rebecca Fibrink, and she is a senior lecturer at Goldsmiths, University of London. She designs new ways for people to use machine learning in creative practice, including the design of new musical instruments, embodied games, and interactive art. Description of this session is as follows. We will bring together experts in the field of neurology, psychology, cognitive science, music performance, and machine learning to explore the generative process humans undergo to create music. We will discuss research from diverse fields that shed some light on the complex process and demonstrate how these new insights are being used to inspire new forms of creativity with technology. I'd like to stop on that one, include that one, because I always put up the South by Southwest mission statement. South by Southwest celebrates creativity. South by Southwest dedicates itself to helping creative people achieve their goals. Details, details, details. If you are in a band, if your neighbor's in a band, if your friend's in a band, know that the final deadline for entering your band or showcase for 2019 is October 25th. Getting pretty close to that. If you are a startup, music-related startup, the South by Southwest pitch final deadline is November 15th. South by Southwest Pitch is the new name for what was previously called the South by Southwest Accelerator Pitch Competition. Find more information on that at sxsw.com/pitch. You can always email me for more information about South by Southwest, hugh@southbysouthwest.com. Again, remember, tomorrow is our first Music Fest announcement of the season. We have about 100 bands that we'll announce tomorrow. Now we have a few minutes for questions. Whoever's got the best South by Southwest related question wins a free badge.
You said you had the biggest content offering, like
that's today. No, today is we always typically have this announcement around mid-October. It's we'll end up having probably 1,200, 1,300 total sessions, but between now and March, we'll dribble out like 10 at a time. Today's the biggest, like 600 at once.
Are you expecting like the biggest crowd ever? Because I know last year was...
No, I don't. I mean, we may grow a little. We had some huge growth years between 2004 and 2014. We've mainly kind of leveled off at this point.
Okay.
So, and always quality is better than...
So I just moved here, but I've heard South by Southwest can be pretty overwhelming for like first time goers. How do you like maximize, I guess, the experience if you're trying to enjoy it from like a music standpoint, but also more the networking and technology aspect as well?
You are absolutely, well, first, welcome to Austin.
You
are absolutely correct. South by Southwest can be overwhelming for first time goers as well as long time attendees. It is sensory overload. You'll see that's a good thing. Sometimes it can be overwhelming. There's 50 different things happening at once. The best way, I think, to maximize the opportunities at the event is simply taking a significant amount of time between now and March and plan. Figure out what your goals are at the event, whether you're buying a badge or whether you're not buying a badge, who you want to meet, what sessions you want to attend, what parties you want to attend, what bands you want to see, what films you want to see. Have a strategy. Much better to have a strategy and divert from that strategy if some kind of serendipitous opportunity comes up. But I would do that. I would suggest that is a much better approach than just hoping serendipity will happen, which it might, but you might be disappointed if it doesn't. So again, with today's announcement, we have the first kind of shell of the South by Southwest schedule for 2019. Begin to study that. Once you register, once you establish an account, you can star things you like, which just puts it into your schedule. You can begin to put together a schedule that way. You can change the schedule to use that schedule functionality. You don't need to pay anything at all. But again, study the schedule, figure out who you want to meet, what you want to learn, what your goals are. And as always, whether it is the Austin Music Tech Meetup or South by Southwest, try to meet as many people as possible. That's the key to success.
Can I add to your answer? Always, if you go, have multiple options per time slot, because to your point, I can guarantee you will meet someone you're not expecting, you will do something that you're not expecting, you will get hungry when you weren't expecting, and it'll just reroute your plan for the next session. So always kind of have a backup. But it's like the funnest 10 days of the year, so just kind of go, especially the first one, just kind of go with it.
Cool.
But definitely to Hugh's point, if there's anyone that you really want to meet, like optimize your chances to meet that person, send them an email before South By and say, hey, here's why I really would like to meet you, and figure out a time to go. Sorry.
All good. And those are, I will say that do as I say, not as I do, those are life lessons also. Have a plan and have a backup plan.
Just a general question. We're new here also. So a badge, does that like give you access to everything at South by Southwest or?
The badge gets you access to panels, presentations during the day, as well as showcases at night. All that stuff is contingent on capacity. So if you have a badge and a room is full, you can't get in. The fire department won't let us do that. There are many other ways to attend or participate in South by Southwest without purchasing a badge. If you're just interested in seeing music, for instance, you can buy a wristband, which is significantly cheaper. If you're just interested in seeing movies, you can buy a movie wristband, which is significantly cheaper. We have a gaming expo the second weekend of South by Southwest, which is much cheaper than buying a badge. If you have a badge, you get it free to that gaming expo. Otherwise, you can buy a pass for that. So the badge is the best way to, you know, maximize the opportunities of South by Southwest. It is a little bit expensive. There are discounts for students, discounts for groups, that type of thing. But, you know, to my previous point, what was added here, you know, if you're going to make that kind of investment in a badge, and it's a pretty significant investment in a badge, you want to plan, you want to have a backup plan, you want to make the most out of your time and out of the money you're going to put into that. All the way back.
What's a favorite memory that comes to mind, or like a favorite South by experience for you?
Well, I think I said one last month, so I have to think of a different one. certainly 2 years ago, getting the opportunity to meet President Obama before he went on stage. It was pretty cool. He had just come from Torchy's, if you're familiar with that story. I think he was still like holding the bat. I've since met him a couple of other times, that was pretty neat. I don't think I'll ever have anything quite as special as that, but it was great to have him involved in the event. And you know, one of the stories I sometimes tell, which is related to that, is that, you know, they had something like, the White House had something like 250, 300 people in as a support team for that, which is what they travel with. That said, we've had other big name speakers who have been a lot bigger hassle than dealing with the president's team. They were really easy to deal with. They know what they're doing. They come in, they come out, you know, military precision, as they would say.
Is there going to be any like hands-on component to the pitch piece, like the startup stuff?
It's pretty much a standard, typical pitch where we'll probably have about 500 startups from around the U.S. and around the world apply. Of that, 50 are selected as finalists. Finalists are coached significantly beforehand, then they get a two-minute pitch. It's a pretty neat experience, and there is. You'll see a pretty big international participation, so it's a pretty cool way to bring together a lot of entrepreneurs and founders, you know, which is, you know, very much at the heart of what South by Southwest is all about.
For those events, in which way can we get in contact with, like before or after the events, in which way can an attendee get in contact with a present, with a panelists? Or
we have a thing called South by Southwest Social, which is kind of an in-house social network, and is mainly a way to prevent anyone from registering from getting a lot of spam. I mean, it just kind of goes to a third-party interface that you can check into. For a lot of speakers, you can track down their email addresses pretty easily. But the speakers are coming to an event like South by Southwest for the same reason that you guys are attending. They want to meet people, they want to network with people, they want to connect with people. So generally they're pretty receptive to meeting with you if you're, you know, what you're doing is something that aligns with what they're doing.
Does South by pay some of the headliners to come talk, like Mark Cuban, for example, or are they just coming for the network?
We have a pretty strict, across the board for 30 years, policy that we don't pay people to speak, simply because with the amount of speakers we have, we started doing that, it would get very expensive very quickly. So, you know, for most speakers, the reason they're at South by Southwest is to, again, leverage the exposure of the networking opportunities. And typically, for bigger names, the reason they're speaking at South by Southwest is they have a new project, new book, new movie, new website to promote. And South by Southwest is a great way for them to get their message out to a lot of people, one place over the space of 2 or 3 days that would otherwise take a lot longer. But we're cheap.
When you were saying earlier about blockchain is a big theme of this year, do you guys pick the themes before you pick the panels, or do you do do the themes emerge based off what you guys select?
That's a great question. It's a little more the latter than the former, in the sense that that with what comes in the panel picker, the themes become a little more obvious. But I would like to push more in future years where we are being more aggressive in selecting themes. One of the examples of that is I mentioned that we have this new canna business track. This is the first year we've had a canna business track. We've had cannabis sessions before, but a year ago, we didn't have a canna business track. And we got something like 10 proposals based on cannabis. This year we had a cannabis business track. Yes, the industry is a year at more advanced or mature, however you want to say it, but we got 60 proposals. So I think that, for instance, in 2020, if we did a quantum track, we would get 30, 40, 50 proposals on quantum, whereas if we didn't do a quantum track, we probably wouldn't get that. So again, I think that in the future we are trying to get more comfortable with predicting what things are going to be hot and what we want to cover more, as opposed to what does the community want to cover.
And follow up, has a theme emerged that you're like, this is going to be really cool this year?
Well, I think that, again, to what I showed, blockchain is everywhere. We know that. We know that there are three different blockchains events a week here at Capital Factory. AI, certainly big, and there was some AI-related stuff in what I showed. I think another thing that, like it or not, is a big theme this year is the whole concept of, what might be called digital distrust, data privacy, kind of the social media backlash, that we are, we're all less drinking the Kool-Aid on these systems than we were 3, 5, 10 years ago, when we were all saying, technology is going to fix everything, and now we realize that it fixed a lot of things, but it created a lot of problems, and I think that'll be a theme that we see a lot in 2019 as well.
Let's do two more questions. We've got a burning question.
If there's no other question. With South by having tech and film and music, do you foresee any of those becoming more prominent in the future?
Well, in fact, tech has kind of overwhelmed music and film the last several years, and I think that's just, the market reason or whatever, that software eats everything and there's a tech backbone to everything. I think we'll see more health stuff in future years. A lot of that is because the new Dell Medical School in South by Southwest always reflects what is hot in Austin. It's certainly important to continue that music and film stuff because they're a big part of the creative backbone of South by Southwest, but tech certainly, the tech folks, like it or not, are most active in going to panels even at night like this. They've got the most resources to come to Austin, so there at this point is more tech than music and film. But it is an important balance to try to kind of keep that relatively equal. Okay, last question.
I have a question. One thing that's really interesting about South by Southwest is that it tries to bring together a lot of different things like music and tech and or cannabis or blockchain. Are there any ways that you're trying to keep those areas from being siloed, because there are those different tracks, but are there any ways you're trying to bring those things together so that people can feed off of each other in different ways?
Yeah, that's a great question also. I think that, in fact, we very much kept those areas siloed for the first 25 years of South by Southwest. We are now in an era where we're trying to do a better job of merging all those things, you see a lot more tech in the second half of the week than what was traditionally the music part of the week. The badge functionality has changed such that if you have an interactive badge, you can go to a lot more music stuff or film stuff now. So we're trying to encourage those connections. I think one of the, as much as I hate the word value propositions, one of the value propositions of South by Southwest is that you do have all these different communities coming together, and often that's the thing that you can learn the most of at an event at South by Southwest, is meeting someone from a completely different community who teaches you about blockchain in a way that you didn't understand before, and can kind of, you know, fully understand this thing or better understand this thing, and opens up some new doors. So again, that is always a tricky balance. Also, you know, you're telling people on the one hand you can find your tribe at South by Southwest, but also encouraging them to explore beyond their tribe and find new things. Okay, I've been a lot more than 5 minutes. Thanks for the time. Hopefully I'll be back here again next month doing the same thing. Tell your friends and colleagues all about this stuff during music, more tech stuff. For tonight's winner, we'll go with our newcomer there. Welcome to Austin. And come back next time. All of you come back, please, with more good questions, and we'll give away another badge then. Thank you very much.
Awesome. Thanks again.
Thank you.
All right, well, the later point that Hugh was making about being excited about, not excited, but one of the trends emerging being the emergence of data, or the downsides of data, is super relevant, because that's literally what we're going to talk about today. And if you guys are familiar with, actually, I think this will be a really interesting talk, because I don't know the breakup of the room as far as entrepreneurs versus musicians versus developers, but this is something that will affect everyone on the business side, or as we, the consumers, because it relates to our data, who can use it, who owns it, what's okay and what's not okay to do with data. And where a lot of people were thinking that the reaction would come from the US and as being the one of, or not considered the tech leader of the world, it's actually Europe that's leading as far as protecting data. And so that is gonna be the topic of today. I think this stuff is fascinating. Music, as always, has this particular nuance and additional complications for it. So you can come on up. And are you ready with the presentation?
Yeah, just put it in.
So with that, I'm going to turn it over to, let me hide your conversations. log in as you, or is she going to log in?
She says,
you know what?
We
literally talked this through.
I'm trying to touch the screen, but it's not my
setup. Talk this through at length. I'm just gonna let you do the introduction to everything.
All right, cool. I don't know what this music is.
Ooh, it's
a
little
nice.
Santana, get the week just right. Is this still on the Halloween playlist?
Yeah,
sure.
But now I don't know where the, I haven't used an Apple in so long. There it is. Okay.
Sorry, so that was like the worst intro ever.
Oh, that's all right. No problem. Yeah, I was going to introduce myself anyway, so all good. My name's Elise. I am an entertainment, intellectual property, and media law attorney here in Austin. I started my own practice about 6 months ago. For me in particular, privacy is really an interesting area. I think it's a real hot topic right now, and kind of as was touched on, it doesn't matter whether you're in the music industry or in the tech industry or just a consumer, it really affects everybody. So. I will point out I am Australian, so I'll probably in this presentation refer to data and data interchangeably. Just bear with me. okay. So first of all, I'm not sure exactly the breakup of the room, but when we're talking about big data, I'm just going to show you this quick video to kind of go through the basics. I know this might be some basic information for you guys, but just to cover all bases.
Does the term big data scare or confuse you? Fear not. Let us break it down for you. Big data is the act of collecting large data sets from traditional and digital sources to identify trends and patterns. That information is used by companies to improve what they know about customers' wants and needs. The goal should be to make solid decisions based on data and not just hunches. People are increasingly willing to hand over their personal data return for products and services that make their lives easier. But what does that mean for you, the source of the data? Well, think of it as a trait. Let's say Becky tweets about a store she recently visited. That store can mine data from her tweet and thousands of others to figure out where its customers are and what they're saying about its products. Maybe the store decides to open a new location way across the city because social media shows the demand there is popping. Tweets and Facebook posts are a bit harder to analyze than structured data like store receipts or web traffic. Unstructured text or images require special software to extract the meaning. And since the volume of unstructured data is so large, many businesses need to use special hardware just to organize and understand it. Companies that are on their game use both structured and unstructured data flow to build up their customer insights each step of the way. Pretty crazy, right? Data-driven marketing is what it's all about these days, and every organization should know the three V's of analysis if they want to succeed. Volume, the amount of data, velocity, speed at which the data is generated, and variety, the kind of data available. The more data a business analyzes, the more it can make the experience better for the customer. For a typical company, just a 10% increase in data accessibility will bring in more than $65 million in net income. So should Becky worry that her information is being passed around between large corporations? Maybe. It's not exactly a regulated practice, but in this day and age, it's nearly impossible to avoid. And data collection is in the year 2020, about 1.7 megabytes of new information will be created every second for every human being on the planet. Even the White House has already invested more than $200 million in big data projects. But just because information is collected doesn't mean it will necessarily be used. In fact, only 0.5% of all aggregated data is ever analyzed. But there are steps Becky can take to limit the amount of accessible data. She can read the terms and conditions before installing apps. Some of them ask to access phone contacts, GPS locations, even microphones. Limit geotags on social media, and be aware that anything you type into a search engine will be documented, even in your private browser. So there you have it. Big data is the ultimate business tool of the future, and it wouldn't be possible without you, the consumer.
That's good for you.
Yeah, so that was just a little video I found from Forbes. That video was created in 2016, so obviously there have been quite a few regulations that have come into place since this was created, the main one being the GDPR. So that's what I'm going to really focus on today as we go through this presentation. If I can make it big again. Okay. So big data and ethics, this is the real question. Some people say it's too late, the data's already out there, it's not coming back, nobody cares, we're just all putting it out there and we just want everything to be efficient and yeah, it's too late to do anything about it. So I guess the EU has a different view and that's why they brought in the GDPR. This is a little clip that I found. My mother-in-law always sends me Dilbert comics, and I feel like there's a Dilbert comic for every situation. Whatever you're thinking of, there'll be one that relates. So. Okay, so how does the music tech industry use big data? We've kind of touched on this a few times if you've been to this meetup. At the moment, it's kind of the main way that the music industry is making money. The best example, I guess, is Spotify. You know, you're listening to music free, but really your data is being sold on behind the scenes, and then they're selling that to advertisers and marketing, and that's how they make their return money. So there was kind of a time where people didn't really know how the music industry was going to make money anymore. It's become very clear that people won't pay for music, so there has to be other ways that they can make money. So what's typically collected? The first one is information relating to how you use the particular service. So the number of plays, the followers, the genres you listen to, playlists, skips, that kind of thing. The second is information relating to your device, so your IP address, device type, geolocation, browser type, and browsing activity if you have a widget installed or there's some other way that it's pulling information from the website that you're on. The third is information relating to you personally. And this is kind of where the GDPR really is, what it's really concerned about is your personal information. So your name, email address, credit card details, interests, gender, marital status, age. There's obviously even more data that's being collected if you use a third-party service to sign up. So for example, for Spotify, if you use Facebook or Google to sign up for your account, they're then sharing information between those two companies, and you're going to have things like photos, your phone contact list, Facebook friends, and social media posts all being shared to each other. So what's it used for? We already kind of said that it is used to generate profit by selling the information to advertisers and marketers. There are other legitimate reasons why this data is being kind of collected and stored and processed. So it is to make the service a little bit more efficient, to personalize your content so you can get those awesome Spotify weekly discover lists, which I personally love. As I said, music recommendations, music industry insight and predictions for the next big hit. So last year, Spotify used its data to predict the Grammy Awards, and they got 4 out of 6 corrects. So that was all just based on the data that they collected. And then also fan engagement, so it's great for artists to be able to see where their fans are located, what countries they're in, and how they can target that particular market. So what is the GDPR? How many people, first of all, have heard of the GDPR? Okay, awesome. I would assume most people. It was kind of quite a big buzz when it was about to be released back in May. So the General Data Protection Regulation came into force back in May. It replaced the 1995 EU Data Protection Directive. So it's been a while since this had been updated, so it was a real significant change. It places really strict rules on how personal information is collected, processed, and stored. So the two main purposes of this regulation, the first one is data protection. So they want to make sure that when data is processed, that it's being stored safely and that you're making sure that you're preventing data breaches. That's obviously a big issue at the moment, and something that they were really concerned about while they were making this regulation. And then the second perspective is the privacy perspective. So consumers are a little bit more switched on now. They want to know how the information is being used, and they want to know how you're storing it, if it's being sold to other people, and that was the other kind of perspective that the GDPR has taken. So GDPR in a nutshell, these are kind of the, I guess, 5 main points of the GDPR. They want to make sure that you have clear disclosure to consumers on how the data is used. They want active consent by consumers. That means no pre-ticked boxes. You have to actively consent to what they're using, how businesses are using your information. It also creates a number of legal rights that consumers have when it comes to controlling their data, and I'm going to go through those in a minute. It mandates for data not to be retained for any longer than necessary, so you can't just keep a backup of stored information that's just sitting there. And it also applies to both data controllers and data processors. So previously, just controllers were subject to privacy laws, and it's now processors as well. So the difference between a controller and a processor is a processor is someone that's providing a tool to store the information or to process the information. So for example, a cloud service would be a processor rather than a controller. But it's EU law. If I had $1 for the amount of people that say to me, oh, the GDPR doesn't apply to me, it's EU law, I'm here, my business is in the States, I would be very rich. So. The GDPR does apply to most businesses in the States and anywhere outside the EU for that matter. It applies if you're offering goods or services to EU residents, whether that's free or paid. And it also applies if you're monitoring any EU residents' behavior. So if you have cookies on your website, technically you fall under the GDPR if you have someone from the EU that can access your website. So my safest bet, and this is what I tell clients, is assume the GDPR applies to you. The only circumstance where I can really see it not applying, where it's really clear, is if you have geo restrictions on your website or your app, which prevents people from outside the US accessing those services. If you don't have that, the GDPR probably applies. Why so serious? So, 20 million euro or 4% of your revenue are the fines that can be imposed on any company, and it's the highest of those. It's a lot of money. It is really serious, and that's why a lot of the big companies, you got all those emails updating your privacy policies because of this law. There's also criminal penalties and private lawsuits that may be brought against you if you're not in compliance with the GDPR. So the definition of personal data. Previously, it hasn't been very clear what exactly personal data is. Obviously, there's the main things like your name, your address, your credit card details, social security number, all those things where you clearly are able to be identified. The GDPR really broadens this and pretty much says that it's any information related to an identified or identifiable natural person. So this includes what previously wasn't included, such as IP addresses, your interests, your education. If you can put enough information together to have an outcome where someone can be identified, then that's personal data. So it's really, really broad. And as it says here, it's, you know, one or more factors specific to the physical, physiological, genetic, mental, economic, cultural, or social identity of that person. So pretty much anything. There's also two other categories that the GDPR kind of talks about. I'm not going to go too much into them, but there's what they call sensitive data. So race, politics, religion, union membership, genetics, health, gender, and sexual orientation are all referred to as sensitive data. There's stricter regulations under the GDPR that applies to that data. And then there's also another separate category for criminal convictions. So any information that's dealing with that, again, there's separate regulations under the Act. So pseudo and anonymous data. Some people think that as long as their data is in an anonymized or pseudo format, that the GDPR doesn't apply to them because it's not personal data, because you can't identify someone. So this isn't a very correct assumption. Under the GDPR, pseudo information is actually still considered personal information. So the difference between pseudo information and anonymous information is that pseudo information, you have you keep one set of data over here and then you keep the other set of data over here, and they're kept separately, so you don't know who the person is. But if there's a potential to bring the data together, then you can still identify the person, and that's pseudo information. Anonymous data, it means it's impossible to identify the person, so that other separate information is completely deleted and you can't access it. From my experience, if someone's saying that they use anonymous data, it's probably not. It's very hard to make data anonymous, in, you know, completely anonymous. So most of the time, again, it kind of err on saying it's going to probably be pseudo instead of anonymous data. So these are some questions to ask to kind of distinguish whether it is or not. So is it still possible to single out an individual? Is it possible to link records or other information that would then allow for an individual to be singled out? And can information be inferred concerning the individual? If you answer yes to any of those questions, then the GDPR still applies. So don't think just because it's aggregate information that it's not doesn't fall under. So legal basis for processing. These are the only ways that you can process data in a legal way. The first one is consent, and that has to be active consent, as I mentioned before. Then the ones that follow, I like to look at as a backup legal basis. I think getting consent, active consent, is the best way to kind of comply with this regulation. But the backup ones are if the information is necessary to perform a contract, if you're complying with legal obligations, if you need to protect the vital interests of the consumer, if it's necessary for a legitimate interest of the controller. Some people try and get away with that. It's not a good way to go about it. It's really hard to meet that bar. Or if it's necessary to carry out a task in the public interest, or if it's necessary to prevent fraud. So they're all valid bases to process data without having that consent necessarily there. The circumstances where that normally applies is if a consumer has come through and requested for their information to be deleted, but you need to retain that information, say, for tax purposes. This would give you a valid basis to do that. So profiling. There's a direct section in the regulation that directly deals with profiling. When I'm talking about profiling, I mean advertising and marketing that is targeted based on an individual's interests. So a consumer has a right not to be subject to profiling. Profiling is only allowed if it's necessary to perform a contract, if it's authorized by a member state which has safeguards for rights and freedoms in place, or if the consumer has given explicit consent. So this is actually, this consent definition in here is a little bit different to the rest of the Act. The rest of the Act, you can technically have consent without, you know, it can be active by just having a privacy policy. With this marketing and profiling, it has to be explicit, so they have to really click and say, yes, I agree to being targeted by advertising. Any privacy policy should also lay out the logic behind profiling and the consequences of being allowed to use the information in that way. Consumer rights. So this applies to all of us as a consumer. Under the GDPR, you have the right to access, amend, delete, withdraw your consent, and request for a transfer of your data from any company that is online that is processing any of your information. So you have that right. You can go out there if you want to know what Google's processed on you. You can send them a request and they have to comply and get back to you. So in order to be able to comply with this particular part of the act, it's really important that you understand where your data is being stored, how it's being processed, what exactly you're collecting. If you don't know that, then you're not going to be able to comply, and then those fines are going to come into play potentially. Do I need an EU representative? There is a part in the Act which calls for a data protection officer to be in the EU. This person needs to be available to be contacted to have any questions about your privacy policies. This isn't necessarily necessary for a lot of smaller businesses. It more applies to the bigger kind of players, or if you're processing sensitive information or data related to criminal convictions, then also you will have to have a DPO. Obviously, this kind of, like, whether you're processing information occasionally or whether it's part of your business a little bit more seriously, it kind of depends on the nature and the context, the scope, the purpose of why you're processing the data. So it's kind of hard to say whether you need a DPO or not. Compliance. So this is a little strategy that I found from SAS Analytics, which I thought was really good and kind of set out some 5 steps to kind of get yourself in compliance with the GDPR. So first of all, discover. Discover all your data sources, determine how data comes into your business and what happens to it and how it leaves. It's really important to understand that. Identify. So once you have access to all the data, you need to inspect it, identify what's personal data and what's not personal data and what falls under this act. There are tools that can help you do this. You know, a lot of bigger companies have a lot of data kind of sitting there in online storage warehouses or in the cloud or wherever it's stored. So there is software to kind of go through that for you and help you out. Govern. So this comes down to privacy policies, contracts with third parties, employee policies and employee contracts. So you want to make sure that the data is only being accessed by a limited amount of people, because the moment you have multiple people accessing it, you don't know where it's going, you don't know how it's being processed. So it's really important to have employee policies in place that kind of, you know, determine who has access, have passwords in place, and make sure you understand that. This also develops kind of a level of control over the data, so you can directly know how it's being processed from point A to point B. Protect. So protect the information by using encryption. That's the main way to do it. And having passwords and IT security in place, you know, your basic virus protections the real basic of it, but obviously there's other security measures that you can put in place to prevent data breaches. On the topic of data breaches as well, the GDPR does have a 72-hour notification requirement. So if you have a data breach, you really need to be prepared to deal with that quickly, let people know how you're fixing it, who's been affected. So that's kind of important to point out. Audit. I suggest doing a regular audit. You know, make sure that you can produce these documents if you're asked on the spot. Under the GDPR, they do have authorities that can come round. I don't know if they would come to the US for a small business necessarily, but it's still a good idea to kind of have these documents sitting there. But they can come in and request, it's called a privacy assessment that you should have drafted up, and they can request for that. And you should be able to present it on the spot, tell them how you're using your data, why you're using it, and demonstrate that if you did have a customer come in and say, hey, I want all the data that's been processed on me, that you would be able to comply with that request. So these are some more practical tips that I kind of have for you guys. The first is update your privacy policy. This needs to be drafted in plain English. You can't have legalese in there anymore. It needs to be understood by the average person. Also, it needs to be really tailored to your business. So it's kind of, you know, you used to be able to get away with just having a form privacy policy that you kind of found online. It's really not a good idea to do that anymore. Every business, you know, goes through their data differently, and so it really does need to be tailored to your specific business. Create a formal document that clearly sets out how the data is used. So this is the privacy assessment document that I was just talking about that needs to be able to be produced if it was asked for. Ask your partners how they're using data and make sure that contracts reflect your own privacy expectations and the GDPR. So it's important, some of the older contracts obviously didn't contemplate the GDPR and privacy policies, so it's really important to update those contracts. You know, even with agents just that you contract work out to, make sure that they're complying with the GDPR, because you don't want their non-compliance coming back down on you, so you want to have indemnification clauses in there to kind of back you up as well. Make sure that consent from consumers is active. No pre-tick selections. This is why you're getting all the annoying boxes popping up when you go to websites. You have to click I agree, and that's why whenever you put in an email address lately, you have to click for marketing and all that sort of thing. Use data governance programs to help you store and track the data you're processing. So, you know, if you ask around other businesses, they'll be able to give you some good recommendations on some programs that will help you do this. Use real-time analytics rather than post-dated analytics. So most businesses are already doing this now. Post-dated analytics were kind of gone a little bit out. But, you know, you shouldn't just have data sitting there for no reason. If you're not using it, delete it, get rid of it. There's no point in having it sit there. So GDPR, practical impact. So people were really, really scared when this regulation came out or was proposed. The main reason in the music industry in particular, was because they were scared that they weren't going to be able to make money off people's data anymore. In a practical sense, I don't know how true that is. You know, how many people actually read privacy policies? How many people just click agree when a box pops up and you just want to get rid of it because it's being annoying? I don't know. I think people are smarter about how their information is being used and they want to know, but I don't necessarily think that too many people are stopping using Spotify because of their new privacy policy. If you want a service, you're going to use it no matter what. Biggest impacts, though, is obviously the compliance. That's a lot for especially a small business to get through, and that's where the most difficulty is. The other kind of big impact is email marketing. I think, if anything, consumers are sick of getting spam emails and sick of just their email address being given to anybody and everyone. So when you do have that click box, most people are not going to opt in to get email marketing, and so that's where I see the biggest impact in terms of marketing. This is just some fun facts I found through a research from Carnegie Mellon University. So the average word of a privacy policy is 2,518. It takes about 10 minutes to read one. It would take 25 full days to read every privacy policy that you encounter in a year. This study was done quite a while ago. I imagine that this has significantly increased considering now that nearly every website has a privacy policy. don't forget about the other privacy laws. So there are more. we've got HIPAA, which has to do with health-related data, if you're processing that. We also have PCI compliance that has to do with credit cards. COPPA, which has to do with children accessing information online and whether your services are particularly targeted at children. The FCRA, the Fair Credit Reporting Act, applies to credit reporting agencies. And then there's also individual state data breach acts and data privacy acts. So the US does not have a universal privacy data privacy act. I would assume that it will probably happen in the future. Now that we have the GDPR, there's a little bit more pressure to kind of get that happening. But at the moment, all the states have different legislation, so it can be really hard to kind of know what process exactly you have to follow with. Especially with data breach, there's a lot of different notification laws out there. California probably has the strongest protection out of all the states, so the way most people do it is they comply with, if you're complying with California, then you're generally complying with the rest of the country's individual laws. This is a quote I found from Dove Seedman, who is an ethics, who owns an ethics and compliance management firm. So thanks to big data, machines can now be programmed to do the next thing right, but only humans can do the next right thing. So I thought that was kind of on point with ethics and data. It wouldn't be a legal presentation without a fine print, so this is just educational, and I'm not giving any client attorney advice. Thanks. Does anybody have any questions? Yeah, go for it.
Has anyone been... I guess I have two questions.
Mm-hmm.
First, has anybody been dinged really hard by these laws? And then second, I can't figure out if this feels more like when Napster was out and they were just trying to scare people, but they never actually followed through except for a handful. So in your opinion, do you think they're going to cut, is the hammer coming down on a lot of small, probably starting with big companies, but
mm-hmm.
then working their way to small companies where this is going to really impact a lot of people?
Yeah, so to answer your first question, yes, there's been some kind of movement, especially against Google and Amazon, where people have tried to access their data under these laws and they haven't been able to produce it. So there are, you know, that's kind of happening. This law is still so new that there hasn't been any full lawsuits kind of go through yet, but it'll be interesting once it kind of gets there. In terms of the fines, I think definitely, obviously, they're going to be going after the bigger companies first. You know, I don't want to say that they're not going to come after small US business, but, you know, I can't say yes or no, really, in terms of that.
My question was related. So, like, what is their own policy regarding active policing of this? Do they
mm-hmm.
just, like, pick companies and go see if they can get information?
Yeah, pretty much. And consumers can make, you know, you can report people. So if you can't actually access this information, they can report you to the agencies, and then the agencies will come through and they'll investigate you. So that's kind of how it works.
So can only EU citizens make complaints, or can a U.S. citizen ask
only
to do
EU.
The work?
Yeah, only applies to EU citizens. So even though you have to comply as a U.S. business because you might have EU citizens accessing your services, you can't have U.S. Obviously, there's other laws that U.S. citizens can undertake, and the California law is the best way to go about that. But yeah, not if you're a U.S. citizen, you can't act, you know, make a complaint under the GDPR.
So if a European authority requires a company to disclose certain information, mm-hmm. the company says that it's private information because, like, either proprietary, if we're talking about, like, customer lists or
mm-hmm.
something like that, like, what's, like, the tools that they have to enforce the GDPR?
It's a good question. I actually am not sure. I mean, they, you know, if you have trade secret law, I'm not sure if that would kind of, if your trade secrets would trump this new regulation or not. That would be something that would have to go through the courts. It's not explicit in the regulations. So that's, you know, the interchange between different laws, that's generally in that situation, is once it starts going to court, we'll find out.
So have you heard any stories of people requesting information for fun and getting
oh, yeah.
back, and like how
long they are,
mm-hmm.
or what it looks like.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, you can request your whole Facebook history, I've heard. So, yeah, it's like, you know,
wow.
thousands of pages. But if you request it, they have to give it to you, so. Yeah, there's some fun Reddit threads of people kind of trolling, so if you're ever interested, sometimes I get deep in there.
How does one request records on Facebook or Google, for example?
Most of them in their privacy policies will tell you directly how to do it. They'll have a phone number or an address or an email address, or if they have a DPO, you would contact them directly.
Okay.
And they'll have to process it. There's no time limit in how long they have to kind of turn it around, but it does have to be a reasonable amount of time. They can't just drag it on forever and not get back to you.
And since you work with a good amount of entertainment companies, in your opinion, how seriously are people starting to take this? Have you seen an uptick in people asking a lot of questions? Are people signing up to you or anyone else to say, hey, go through all my stuff and make sure that I'm compliant?
Yeah, definitely. I think especially startups, if you're just a sole proprietor, in general, they're not taking it as seriously. And if you have a good... The regulation says that you have to have made a fair effort to comply. So if you're a smaller company and you have, you know, you've talked to an attorney, you've had a privacy policy drafted up and you have that and you're trying to comply with the act, you're not going to get hit with these massive fines. Where they're more concerned about it is if you're trying to avoid telling people how exactly you're using their data, and if you're selling it and not telling people that, that's where you're going to get in real trouble for it. And for the music industry, obviously, that's a big one, because a lot of the time they don't want to tell people that they are selling their information.
Yeah, so question to the group, is anyone who's applying this model of I'm giving away a service, doesn't have to be music particularly, but anything, does hearing this scare you as far as I'm going to get dinged, or are you just thinking, oh, I just need to be more trained? Because to me, what I can't decide if this is more of a punishment or if this is just, oh, well, you seem to be honest with your customers, which
yeah.
ultimately is fine. So what do you guys think? Just shout it out. Anyone who is using this model or just as a consumer?
Yeah, I think your second answer was the right answer, is businesses should just feel that, hey, we can, there's a lot more of, you can be a lot more transparent about your data, because the question came up of trade secrets. Personal data shouldn't really be a trade secret. You should be able to tell people what you're doing with their stuff. So I think the good businesses are going that direction.
I think that's the hopeful side, but that's going to come with an increase in cost. Like, I think we're going to see more of this trend of subscription-based services, because so much of what we use is free because of the reality of what this is long game. So, I mean, ultimately, I think it's a good thing, but is it going to further stratify access to tools? Like, I don't know, some weird knock-on effects.
My kind of perspective is just lay it all out there. Just tell people how you're using their data, and then you're kind of in the safe. I read a really funny, probably not really GDPR compliant privacy policy the other day, but it pretty much just said that we have a chip in you and we're tracking everything that you do. We're not kidding. Don't sue us. We're using everything. So
nice.
I mean, that's one way to go about it, I guess.
But I think like if you disaggregate the personal information, at the end of the day, what matters is like big data, right? So if you want to see trends in consumption and in behavior, like, apart from the email marketing use of data, I think all of the other uses that firms make are, you don't really need the personal data to do that. You need maybe like demographics and, you know, like maybe of the
personal data under the GDPR. So the thing is, the restrictions do lower once you have kind of aggregated that information and it's not as personally identifiable. They do kind of lower the restrictions and they kind of incentivize you to do that in the act. And so you can change your purpose, for example, without updating the person, and they, you know, a person can't come in and request that data, for example. But it is still personal information, so.
So following up on that, could you sell the information without the personal information, Like,
you can, but when you collect it
to begin with. So you remove the names and the email addresses. There's no way to link that, but you send. You can sell.
Like purchase history.
But exactly. It's for the person.
Yeah.
So it's really just an algorithmic advance away from, like, the data being illegal. I mean, it's so easy to infer who a person is from a few data points now.
And that's why I kind of say it. Don't think that it's anonymous. The information you have, I would kind of treat it as pseudo data.
It was speaking directly to, like, geolocated data and stuff too, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. There was another, who was it? AOL. They put out, I don't know if anybody remembers this, but they released their database of keyword searches from people. And they kind of just took out the IP addresses and gave everybody a random number. But based on the searches, you could still personally identify so many people just based on what they were searching on Google. So that's kind of a good example where you think you're doing the right thing, but you definitely haven't. So,
what are some of the biggest cases that you read about where people requested data and they said, we can't do that, we don't have it, or whatever?
Well, because this act is so new, it only came into effect in May. There haven't been any big penalties kind of come down yet, but I'm sure it will happen sooner rather than later, I imagine. So.
Yeah, it seems like a lot of work.
Definitely.
To get the data.
And the other thing is this, people had 2 years to comply. So it was proposed and passed, and then they gave people 2 years to kind of get their acts together. So there was time to kind of get it all happening.
And a lot of the stuff that you showed here today seems more related to, I'll call it malicious use of data, but is there any penalties for sloppy use? So like when a Facebook goes, oops, we didn't know it, but we messed up and somehow the data's been hacked or leaked or whatever. Is there any punishment for that within the scope of GDPR or anything else? Or is it strictly just, I know what I'm using it for, I'm not telling you, or I'm using it for commercial purposes without your full consent?
Yeah, I mean, potentially it could be both. I think if you've just kind of tried your best to comply, and you can demonstrate that you have tried your best to comply, then they're going to go easier on you. For example, the Facebook with the Cambridge Analytics kind of saga. I'm sure Facebook pulled out all of their stuff to say, hey, we were trying to tell people, or we were, trying to be in compliance. I think if you're making your best effort, then this is more to kind of, and it's not to scare people either. Like, I know the fines are really big, but it is really for that kind of malicious intent behind it and trying to deceive people about where the information is going and who it's being sold to. So.
Awesome. Well, thank you very much. That was great. Cool. Well, it's now, 8:30? Do you want to go around the room quickly? I don't know if we have enough time. I'm trying to think if there's anything we can do as a group since it's such little time for. No, thanks again, that was fantastic. So we could use the rest of the time to just network, hang out, or do you guys want to. Well, when you say around the room, it just means say your name and something quick about yourself. And that way, maybe. I guess they're going to kick us out of the room in 30 minutes, but why don't we do around the room, and then if there's someone you really want to talk to, just take it outside after the meetup.
Just time box it. 10 seconds per person.
You're the timekeeper. All right, cool. I'll start it. I'm Luis. I'm the organizer for the group. Thank you guys for coming. So excited to see this group. We were talking about it earlier. 4 years going strong for the music for the meetup.
10 seconds.
Dang it. All right. So Luis, not here looking for anything. Just excited to meet you guys. And thanks again to Elise and then to Hugh who left. Back to you.
I'm Alex, also a music tech organizer here. I work in smart home IoT. Looking forward to meeting everyone here. That's it.
And I know that we're kind of being rushed, but if there's anything that you're particularly looking to get out of, if you're looking to meet someone with a particular skill set or test that, I'd make sure that you get to that. Go ahead, we'll go this way.
Bronche Brown, building a photography on demand platform. This is my second. I'm attending.
I'm Ellie Yada, and I work for an energy efficiency startup here at Capital Factory, and I'm a DJ.
Cool.
You guys.
software engineer at sumo.com, focusing on full stack JavaScript.
Santiago Cervantes. I'm an entrepreneur from Mexico City focusing on solving ticket scalping back home and currently starting an MBA here at UT.
Excellent.
My name is Dickie. I'm just first time here looking at trying to work on something to flip kind of the music industry to support artists rather than support fat cats.
My name is Derry. I work at Waymo as a fleet systems operator, and I'm also an avid musician. I play bass and guitar, write my own music, and gig in a band.
My name is Mark Peterson. I'm a graphic designer, musician, producer, and I'm looking to just make connections and see what people are doing in Austin.
I'm Justin. I'm a co-founder of this company called Sonic Boom. We're doing production music discovery and licensing, and I don't know, just meeting the IO community, how tech community.
Juan Rojas, I am a developer, freelancer, contractor, whatever, somewhat of a musician, and I work at an AI company that people probably spend since I can tell you about.
I'm Stephen Wilkinson, founder and CEO of Second Brain. We built a rap guide, taught at ML Algo English through hip hop lyrics. Like an AI co-writer kind of thing. Been doing that for 2 years. Looking to meet like anybody making music, working with AI stuff, devs, and creative peeps.
I'm Mackenzie. We are actually from Nashville. Our company's called Evamore. We automate the booking process of live music. So looking for bands to book.
Expanding to Austin, so that's what we're here. So, yeah. My name's Channing.
I'm Ethan. I guess full stack developer, but mostly focused on front ends. And I'm building a browser based digital audio workstation with real time collaboration. So I was hoping I could talk to some other developers and, you know, meet everyone.
I'm Cameron. I'm a freelance editor and graphic designer, and I just like to make beats. And first time here.
And I'm Terry, father of Cameron. First time here, new to Austin. Photographer, producer, working in healthcare right now.
Where do you guys move from?
Nice,
welcome.
I am Malcolm. I do email marketing for our agency up in North Austin, but love music, love technology. First time here, just wanted to check it all out.
I'm Travis Hagen. I'm a freelance graphic designer and also an educator at the Jewish Community Center. I'm just here to network and meet up other bright minds to help the children I'm working with. So.
Cool.
I'm Hillary. I'm a singer-songwriter. I sing with a band and I also teach voice. So if anybody is looking for a voice coach, any musicians, or if you're looking for a singer, anything like that, that's me. And I'm also looking to network with people who produce or just people in the music industry in general. So.
Awesome. Okay. So good job, everyone. That was super efficient. So the rest of we got like 25 minutes to hang out. Beer in the back, water outside, and the rest of the time is just hangout time. So thanks for coming. We'll see you next month.
I was going to buy some.
Okay, sure.
No, what? I'm too paranoid now. I don't want to know shit. I don't want to see shit.
I've just been doing the contracting.
Okay.
But I ended up with this deal just like, and then it's been a really awesome site. But the biggest question that always comes up for me is
thanks again, that was great. That was awesome.
Yeah. Reality is they're going to change.
I can't tell if I'm more like
maybe spending more
like, well, this is good.
Yeah, I think
it's
a good thing.
Yeah, and it's kind of loading off as far as
I'm
I'm very ill, so I'll take a big thing. The idea is that we're going to appreciate it. Yeah, definitely. Nice presentation.
It's sometimes more quiet. It's okay, the weather kind of.
Yeah, oh yeah. Yeah, so normally there's more, but because it's, like, you guys came from Hospice,
yeah.
Hospice is good. You came out, I can start over.
It's supposed to be like,
exactly.
They're going to take the house and put someone like this. My husband said 50%
of
the
attendees are children.
Capital factory
was empty.
Wow.
So you didn't even wear a jacket.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've been freezing all day.
I should have. I'm
underprepared.
So is it gonna warm back up?
Probably. I don't know. I'm into it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It feels good.
Yeah. Are you getting
awesome?
Check that out.
Yeah. They're based in California.
Okay.
They had these Texas.
Yeah, it's good to read.
Put on some.